So I'm Georgia Tanasov. I'm the chair of the board of directors of the Children's Trust and also a member of this year's host committee for this Focus on Fatherhood forum that we're having. We're really excited to have a good turnout to hear from our program panelists and to engage you in a conversation. So we hope that many of you on camera or off camera will be willing to ask some questions either live or in the chat. For the last 6 years or so, we as a host committee and as a Children's Trust have hosted events and special opportunities like this to raise awareness and support for the vital role that fathers play in the lives of their children. And as we look forward to Father's Day this Sunday, we're excited yet again to have another special event to have an engaging and informative, we hope, conversation. We started off 6 years ago having these events in person. Children's Museum, later at the Boston Aquarium. You know, the goal there was to really engage children directly in the event. It was one of the first time that the Children's Trust would have an annual event that actually had the full family participate. And we were proud of that. Obviously, COVID had other plans. We were hoping to do it in person this year, but for a variety of reasons, I've decided to have it virtually. So if you're interested in what you learned today, stay tuned for future years where we'll hopefully have a family-friendly event. We can continue to be engaged with the Children's Trust and learn more. I want to just thank a few sponsors. Without them, events like this and the funding, especially the Fatherhood Initiative itself, would not be possible. So to the Khan Funds for Social Change, to Lifeblood Fund, and to fellow board member Kerry McGuire, thank you so much. Today. Your commitment to the Children's Trust, its fatherhood program, is truly appreciated, and we're grateful to continue to have your financial support. So just in conclusion, thank you again for joining. Hope that you'll engage in conversation again, either asking live questions or in the chat. And with that, I'd like to turn it over to Chris White, who's the Fatherhood Initiative Coordinator for the Children's Trust, who will officially kick off the conversation this morning and run the program. So Chris, over to you.
Morning, everyone, and happy Father's Day weekend. Thanks for joining us today. I was hoping we could start off with a little little whiteboard action and just kind of, if you want to use one or two words, and I'll put it in the chat. What would you want your children to describe you as a father? Pull the whiteboard. Share in there. We type in there.
So if you click what looks like the letter T, you can type and not have to draw.
That's much better. All right, we got loving, caring, dependable. The best, understanding, present, honest, you know, all characteristics of the fathers that we want to be and we want to encourage, you know, with our program participants, with our professionals, and with our own families. Father involvement, it's you know, it's pretty easy to promote because it's connected to so many, you know, child well-being and health indicators. And also, you know, positive indicators for mom's health as well, from reduced depression and stress to you know, increased rates of breastfeeding to reduce smoking, a reduction in smoking, which it's kind of, you know, fun to go through all the different statistics and you know, there's been so much more research in the past 20 years on fatherhood and the impact of father involvement. And that it's you know, it's great, and I feel like it's not as promoted as much as some other important issues. And so that's what we're doing, you know, at the Children's Trust with our families, with our young families at the Healthy Families Home Visiting, with our nurturing fathers groups in the prisons and aftercare, and also with professionals and programs that work with fathers across the state at our FFNs. So we have some exciting presenters here today, and I just want to take some time to introduce them. Milton Kotelchuk, and please forgive me if I mispronounce any names.
It was good enough.
Good enough? All right. Thanks, Bill. Milton, professor of pediatrics at Harvard Medical School and senior scientist at the Center for Children and Adolescent Health Research and Policy at Mass General Hospital for Children. And we also have today Dave Sullivan, the Northwestern District Attorney and Chief Law Enforcement Officer for Hampshire and Franklin Counties. So welcome to Milton and to David. And Vo T. Chum, forensic clinician and nurturing fathers program coordinator out in Hampshire County at the Hampshire County Sheriff's Office. So we want to welcome them here today and kind of go ahead and pass it off to Dave.
Good morning, everybody. I just want to say that it's a great weekend for fathers and for children. And I think Father's Day is really about how we take care of our kids and how we nurture them. So I'm a proud father of three. I have three daughters. So that's why I don't have any hair anymore. I kind of lost it over the ages. But no, they're three great kids and they're grown up now. And I can't thank them enough for all the things they taught me. And in particular, I remember my father and what a great father he was. So I kind of have a unique position in the sense that for the last decade, I've been the district attorney, but I also had the background of being the chief administrator for the Family and Probate Court in Hampshire County. And that really made a difference in my approach toward children and nurturing and understanding how important fathers are in the growth and the nurturing and really who they are as adults later on. And that experience was just fundamentally giving to me because I really saw the good, the bad, and the ugly. And obviously custody disputes and just the number of kids that didn't have fathers because of paternity just not being present for their kids. And kind of flash forward, I had the opportunity to be on the board. I joined about 11 years ago for Children's Trust, and that's been a great experience. It's a wonderful organization. And so as I look toward the Nurturing Fatherhood initiatives, I saw it firsthand through Children's Trust, working with young fathers and how they really grew into good fathers. And the program that you're going to hear from Vute is a tremendous program. I've seen a lot of prison programs. I've seen a lot of jail programs. This particular program, and I've tried to make every graduation, I think I've hit 11 out of the 12 graduations of the young fathers that go through this program. It's an intensive 13-week program where they explore who their fathers were or who their fathers, how they helped them or how they weren't present in their life. And for the most part, many of the young men in jail haven't had that opportunity to have a good nurturing father. And so they're at a loss, a tremendous loss of how can I change that trajectory? And so they really look at who they are and who they, what father they want to be. And it's very moving, the graduation, because the theme is always the father I want to be. And they're given the tools. And it's, I'd have to say, out of any program I've ever experienced in the jail, and I've attended many, the consensus is this is the best program that any of them have been through. We hear over and over again at how it has fundamentally transformed their lives and the lives of their children. When you go to graduation and their families are there, the kids are there, you see the real heart of who they are because they're communicating with their children are there. They're very proud of their dads, but you see that link. And I can't think of a better program to keep people on track, that once they leave that jail, that they have something that is really bonding, and that's the child. And so I know Vute is going to go into a little bit more detail, but I just want to say that when you have this kind of a program, and it's developed into quite a program that is run by the jail, but it wouldn't have happened without Children's Trust, without that that faith that this program could extend into that incarcerated population. And I can't say enough about it. I just want to, you know, thank Children's Trust for giving that guidance and giving that opportunity to, you know, Hampshire Jail, and I know it's extended to several other jails. And I just want to say that this program should be in every jail in America. I can say without a doubt that what it does for these young men is just tremendous. So again, thank you, Children's Trust, and thank you to our sponsors. I really appreciate all the treasure that you've given to this program, and I know it's going to continue to flourish. Thank you, and have a great Father's Day weekend.
Thanks so much, Dave. OT?
Thanks, Dave, for those kind words. And thank you to everyone that's in attendance. Dave, you've been at every single graduation. I know when there's free food, you're there. So I know you're not going to miss one. So yep. We have one coming up as well. So can't wait to see you there. But just with the nuts and bolts of everything, I just wanted to share a little bit about, you know, we started this program back in 2015. And, you know, we started inside the correctional facility, which was under a different administration. We had a different sheriff who retired in 2016. And his big thing was, you know, connecting with the children and providing a group that was sort of strength-based, not really involving anything with their charges or their crimes or anything like that, but really focused on parenting and fatherhood. You know, we were one of the few facilities actually in the country that offer contact visits. And that was something that Sheriff Garvey really, really wanted to continue throughout his tenure as sheriff. With the new administration, we continued that same energy. Our deputy superintendent, got elected as sheriff of Hampshire County and continued investing a lot of resources into this program. After about 4 years of doing it behind the wall, we heard a lot of feedback from our participants and clients saying that they, you know, would love to do the program again. And is there some sort of aftercare plan where they can follow up with services? And myself and a couple other people went to the board at Children's Trust and, you know, sort of pitched this idea saying, is there a possibility we can sort of have an aftercare plan where we can have this in the community? It could be community-based. We can invite other fathers in the community. Some of the requirements would be, you know, whether they had legal issues, probation, DCF involvement, things like that, some sort of justice-involved individuals where we can provide a evidence-based program, a supportive program for fathers. Within I think a year, we ended up connecting with the Northampton Recovery Center, which is right downtown in Northampton, Mass, and provided a space and started this program, and it just has flourished into something that we have been really, really committed and dedicated to. This current cycle, we had a play shop. If you're familiar with the curriculum, we have a play shop in the middle of the curriculum about 8 weeks in to see if the guys can use some of these skills and things that they learn within the group in a play shop setting. And to our surprise, we had 50 people show up. You know, we're talking about family, we're talking about children, and the father's sort of engagement with their families in a play shop setting. This program has been extremely beneficial to some of the people who have been incarcerated due to not being able to see and interact with their children on a personal level, an intimate level due to COVID. So this has been something that's been challenging for us as well, but it's been transformative in connecting men with their children. You know, there are some really, really success stories that we have with the aftercare program. One of our co-facilitators graduated from the program when he was incarcerated, and he currently provides you know, the curriculum to the men now. And he's a sort of a real life example of how we can overcome some of these struggles that he's had, being incarcerated, now showing up every single Tuesday and working with men. And he's my Facebook guy. So he's always on Facebook. He's always connecting with people that way. And it's been a blessing, you know, and he's paid by the Hampshire Sheriff's Office. And, you know, part of his job duties are to provide these services. You know, we also have a really big program of giving back. We've been utilizing gas cards because that has been something that's been extremely powerful, especially with gas prices now. Individuals, you know, getting to the program and things like that have been a challenge for some people. We're not in a city, so it's not like transportation isn't always the best here, public transportation. But what we have been doing is utilizing past graduates to provide rides and transportation for men. And that has been extremely beneficial because they feel like they're giving back. They're still connected with our group and they're still connected with the aftercare plan. And we provide them with gas cards and we'll say, you know what, if you guys drive these guys here and this and that, we'll provide you with compensation with gas. And that in itself has been a really positive thing to continue this program. So we're looking to expand. We're looking to always improve. We're looking to continue with the work that we're doing. And we're really thankful for sort of collaborating with Children's Trust and the DA's office and Northampton Recovery Center. So it's been a real blessing. And I couldn't state the importance of having this connection with not only when they're incarcerated, but when they're outside, and having that continuity of care is invaluable.
Thank you so much, Boti. And Milt.
Hi, I'm Milt Kotelchuk. As people gave an introduction to me earlier, but following up on the comments of David Sullivan, who lost his hair with three kids. You can see I have four kids, so there must be some continuity between having kids and losing hair.
It's a good thing.
It is a good thing. And I will just tell you, this is a total aside, but I'm all now a grandparent of actually 10 kids, which is unbelievable. And one of the great things about being a grandparent is that all those little dumb jokes and sounds that you made when your kids were little, and your kids now roll their eyes at you, but your new grandkids think you are really fabulous with those sounds and those, you know. So I have now 10 kids who will think I'm very funny again, which is what I thought is a really good attribute for a father. You need a sense of humor to get through and to be supportive of your kids. So I too want to thank the Children's Trust for inviting me and for everybody who sponsored this today, and I hope we'll continue sponsoring in the future. I got involved with the Children's Trust because I do research on fathers. I have all my life, from my PhD thesis onward, I've studied kids and their relationships to their parents, but particularly to fathers. And a few years ago, I do a lot of work in home visiting, and I was both inspired by something from the Children's Trust, and I hope in turn I inspired them, which is that I was doing research looking at every father who showed up for prenatal care at Mass General Hospital, at Chelsea Health Center, at Revere Health Center, and was trying to understand what was the early experiences of men, of all kinds of men, becoming fathers. And I quickly learned about the Children's Trust Fund, who I also knew through home visits, for my other home visiting works. And I just want to compliment the Children's Trust Fund, their home visiting program. They are one of the most, if not the most, progressive, father-oriented home visiting program in the country. I know of only one other program in the entire country that even thinks about fathers in home visiting. People pay lip service. Oh, yeah, we'll take anybody who shows up. But they don't actually work to engage fathers. And I really just want to compliment the Children's Trust Fund's program on fathers, that's led now by Steve Pasco and Sarita Rogers, I think was the first founder of sort of this home visiting program, not the only founder of it. Suzanne Bartley, others have also clearly founded this program. But this program does something that no other home visiting program does. It doesn't merely welcome fathers. It expects fathers. It encourages its people to have fathers present at the home visit. So no other program in the country actually requires and provides training for its staff and how to work with fathers. So every year for many years, 5% more home visits were expected to include fathers over the course of the year in their home visit. Now you might think, well, what's a father home visit look like? But the most important thing to remember is usually the fathers kind of go off into the back room when the home visitors come. And that just says, this is the mom's job. It's her responsibility. And if you can get that father to kind of come into the room when the home visitor comes, you change the dynamics and say, no, this is your responsibility, your chance for love, your chance of really being supportive. And one of the really findings from their work, I just have to say, and I repeat it in every talk I give, is that if fathers are involved in home visits, the mother, the infant, and the whole family stay in home visiting longer. They get engaged. That's the central message of its engagement with the father in the family. I hear that actually in that fabulous program we heard about from working in the prisons. I also do some work with fathers who have more difficulty in establishing relationships. But the home visiting program is unique in the country. And I just, one other feature of it that particularly makes it so important is almost all home visiting programs. I'm going to tell you a tale of what happened I learned in the state yesterday in the state home visiting program. Please don't quote me to the state people. They'll be annoyed that I tell you this story. But it describes the difference between this program and one of the state programs that I also am encouraging. In the state program, I asked the question, I'm on their advisory committee, well, what are you doing about the dads? And everybody said the same thing. Oh, they're all welcome. Any dad who shows up, we're welcome. No question about it. But then they said, but really we only focus in on whoever is the main person who cares for the kid or who calls up and starts the home visiting. I said, well, that's always the mom, or pretty much always the mom in your case. And they said, well, that's the case. And I said, well, what do you do for the dad? And they said, Well, they'd be welcome if they were there. So that's the most important difference. In the Children's Trust Fund home visiting program, it isn't merely that the dad would be welcome. There is an expectation that he will participate. Here's the thing. They actually interview the dad. They interview the mom. They interview the dad. There's no other program in the country that does home visiting that talks to the dad and says, how are you feeling? Do you have anybody you can talk to? Is it stressful for you? Is it joyful for you? What could we do to help you be a better dad? And that is the hallmark of a really program that encourages dads. I just wrote out a list of five things that I recommend how to convert any what I think of as mother-centric programs. And home visiting and many programs assume that only the mother cares for the kids. So I always say you need a place that's father friendly, that's welcoming to fathers, which it is, that you make an expectation that the father shows up, that you make that clear, that you provide materials for the dads, that you do staff training. You say, it's not every person who knows how to work with dads. They're not always the easiest to work with. And most of our training programs for home visitors and social workers and many other family-oriented fields are not very dad-friendly. In fact, the jails are probably know much more about dealing with dads than many other places. And you ask them questions. You engage them actively. So let me just, not to keep ranting and raving, but I just want to say that I came to them and I've been working with them for now 10 years. I mean, I volunteer. I talked to Sarita the other day. We just were chatting to say hello. And I said, she told me they're going to do a special program for fathers this next year. That is to say, which I also advocate, is that You want to do things for mothers and fathers, but you also want to really hear the needs of fathers and do something special for them. It's hard being a dad. It's not easy getting off work. It's not easy assuming that you are responsible. And Sarita talked about doing some work on depression and stress, a great topic for dads. They're all stressed, whatever social class you are. There's a lot of issues around stress, but they're doing something. And Sarita's just said, she told me she was doing this. I said, Sarita, I'll be there on your advisory committee. I said, if you're doing a special project with dads, I'm there. And I've been with them and they've inspired me. And I hope I've inspired them. I do think in the end, as I said in the beginning, bald head though it may be, that dads are really important for men's health, for reproductive justice for men, so that they're treated fairly in the birthing process. I work really hard for paid family medical leave that's equal for men and women in the state. That it's really important for the father's health, father's mental health. It's important for their infants. Having the father around, as everybody knows, is tremendously important for their kids. And it's important for the family, for the family, and ultimately for the community. So I really just praise, I can't praise too highly the program that the Children's Trust Fund does. I study this all across the country, and there is literally no other program that consciously involves fathers and really works at it, curriculum, everything. So I thank you for the opportunity to work with you. And I, you know, hope I provide you some excitement. And all of you looking for research, you know, I'm the person who writes a lot of the articles saying why dads are important for little kids. So you can find me, you know, in some academic journals, but it's not academia that brought me to this topic. It's actually enjoying being a father. And I'm really happy that I've had that opportunity in my life. And I love being a grandfather now. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Milt. And you know, hopefully my hair kind of stays a little bit longer with only two kids. But all right. Well, thank you so much to all three of our presenters and for sharing your experiences with the Nurturing Fathers programs and also with Home Visiting and Healthy Families. So now, Georgia, I'm hoping you can kind of start us off, but we want to ask our committee members, you know, why do you support our Fatherhood Initiative at Children's Trust?
Yeah, thanks, Chris. And I'll be brief now, and then we do want to get to some Q&A in the time we have left. So for me, everything that Mel said, but the Children's Trust is the only agency in the Commonwealth that's core mission is prevention of child abuse. We do a lot in the state to support kids and families, but it's literally the only state agency whose core mission is prevention. And you couple that with the work that's unique nationally that it's doing for fatherhood. And it's just a story that I want to get out there. I want to raise awareness because I think it's undertold and it's best in class nationally. And I just hope that more and more people learn about it and we can scale our ability to reach dads all across the state and hopefully across the country. I think we have a few other host committee members on. Zach, Tom.
Yeah, George, I'd be happy to chime in. You know, I think Milt really is an amazing ambassador and says a lot of the words that I was thinking too. You know, being a father is hard, but it is joyful. And that's so true. And I think the Children's Trust, you know, provides tools and resources to fathers to be a better parent is such an amazing service and a public health good. And the ability to help the organization do more of that, but also educate my fellow fathers about what this organization does has been a real pleasure. So it's been a great opportunity to be part of this host committee and hopefully continue to expand upon the work being done by this organization.
Yeah, I'll chime in. Tom Martin, a member of the host committee as well. I think just thanks to all the speakers. I think you guys hit on all key points for me. This for me and it was really personal in terms of just the role that fathers play and needing to have good role models and teaching people that may not have had those in their lives, the skills that they'll need to be good parents. And I think that is such a critical service that the program provides and just so happy to be a part of it. And thanks to everybody for joining today. I think it's a really important work that's being done. So, and thank you to the presenters. I really appreciate the comments, really, really impactful. So thank you.
And I'll jump in. This is Dan Connolly, also a member of the host committee. You know, to directly answer the question, George, that you asked, why support? And to be oversimplify it, I think if there isn't the support, then a lot of bad things happen. We've heard a lot of the good that's done, but you can only imagine what would happen if this program wasn't there. And I know the Fatherhood Initiative and the Children's Trust is deeply involved in these issues and have heard, frankly, the horror stories that are out there. And just without this program, more bad things would happen. And a second reason, I'm originally from Western Mass, Springfield. And what I like about this is it's a statewide program. It's not just Boston centric. There's a lot of support and they do work in Boston, but Boston often gets a lion's share of some of the supports and services. So the fact that this is not only regional, but statewide is a huge plus. And again, without the support for the program, all that goes away. But thanks to everyone and happy to be here this morning.
Hi guys, Kristen, I'll go next if that's okay. You know, I guess I joke one of the main reasons I'll do anything George asked me to do that is number one, but in all seriousness, and Milt hit on this, the joy you get as a parent, you know, I question that when I'm at my seventh baseball game of the week, but the joy you get from a parent is from a dad is much more than you give, right? And I think I hope all fathers get to experience that. We could all use a little more joy here in 2022. So you know, thanks again to everyone and all the work, and you know, it's a great weekend to celebrate Father's Day, and it's a great kickoff to that weekend. So great to be here, and thank you.
Thank you, guys. Back to you, Chris Webb.
All right. Thank you so much to our host committee. And before we get to Q&A, I just want to share some of our plans for the Fatherhood Initiative at the Children's Trust. And you know, overall, we want to enhance the fatherhood programming and increase the number of dads that we reach. And part of the way that we do that is by building or continuing to build the capacity of our Healthy Families programs. And their ability to reach and engage fathers prenatally when possible. There's a correlation between prenatal involvement and being there for the birth, and with it's correlated with later paternal involvement and maternal and infant health. So it's really important, and that's a key advantage of our Healthy Families programs is they do focus on getting in there early, and helping build these skills and encouraging dads to be there for the birth and encouraging that co-parenting. We also, you know, expanding the number of houses of correction that are offering fatherhood curriculum. So continuing to, you know, our work with Hampshire County has been, you know, a wonderful partnership. We want to be able to bring, you know, the same type of programming to other houses of correction across the state. And also, you know, the opportunities for extending or including aftercare programs, as we've been able to do in Hampshire County. And then, you know, expanding access to fatherhood and co-parenting curricula, training, resources and supports, both at Healthy Families, you know, with our Nurturing Fathers curriculum and our partners in the Houses of Correction, and also just, you know, with professionals and organizations that serve fathers across the state. And so we're exploring a partnership with the National Fatherhood Initiative to identify curricular training and other supports for use with new target populations as well, new father, you know, related to fatherhood. And then continuing with our Fathers and Family Network groups and assessing, you know, how can we best promote awareness of the importance and the value that fatherhood brings, and engaging dads, and that just the importance in family support programming overall when we are able to engage dads effectively. You know, thank you so much to our sponsors, to our host committee for you know, for allowing us to do that and to reach more dads and to reach more professionals that work with dads. And so now we are going to open up to Q&A to our three presenters. And I'm also going to throw in the chat a YouTube link to the Hamden County Nurturing Fathers graduation from earlier in the year.
I think we're open for questions, but I would just add a comment, if it's okay, just listening to your presentation. I think the issue of early involvement is really important. One of the sad realities is that particularly our healthcare system and even historically home visiting really saw only the moms as the responsible person. And I think dads get that message. They're not dumb. They go to a place that doesn't say I'm welcome, they withdraw. And that's the beginning. And if you don't start early and you don't make the expectation high early, they withdraw. It's perfectly reasonable to withdraw from that and leave this all to the mom. So you don't get the skills. And the second thing I just would say is skills. You know, none of us were raised. When I give talks, I tell people, you know, changing a diaper is not in your genes. You know, you have to learn it. And if you had no experience around kids, you're not used to being around kids. And most dads and most men really don't have much experience with kids and families. You know, they have families, but not taking care of kids, being around kids. So we need skills. We're not that good at it. We're not the most sensitive sometimes, and we don't know how to do things. And we're nervous to ask. And I'm watching my colleague nod his head as I'm talking, you know, from the prison perms. You can gain those skills. Those are skills, some that can be learned. It takes a while, but people can learn them. You can, you know, you don't know that this is how kids are thinking and you, this is how they think this, when you say this, what they interpret. So I do think these are skills that can be learned. And when I do my studies at Mass General about prenatal care, that's why I go in at prenatal care and ask, what do you need? The staff don't think the fathers need anything. They don't ask them any questions. But the fathers say, oh, I need a lot of help. But they're also embarrassed to admit that they don't know these things. But you can give them these skills. And they want them and need them. And really, as you said, if you start giving them, everybody shows up. 50 people, I heard 50 people showed up at one of your sessions. That's telling you something. That, you know, the desire is there, the learning of skills is there, start early. And that's why the home visiting program is also so important. If you don't start early, you set in motion a chain of events that one of your sponsors said, bad things happen later because you've never done anything with the kids. I'll stop.
And it looks like Chris has a question.
Thanks. Yeah, Dr. Koltychuk, I'm just curious, is there a, in your research, is there the best age to get to dad for the children, or does it matter? I mean, do you see a sort of the later or the older the children are, the harder it becomes? Or just curious on that end.
Well, I'm of the theory the earlier you start, the better, because you build love and trust from the earliest ages of kids. You don't appreciate, you may, as a parent, you may not totally appreciate all the love that's being developed when the kids are really young. So that's really important. But I also am a developmental psychologist at one point, and so I wouldn't give up on anybody at any age. There's something redemptive for the fathers and the kids, even at a later age, to come back and say, you know, I'm sorry I wasn't around, but I can be around now. You know, you can form loving bonds at any age. I prefer earlier. I think it's much easier to relate to kids. You have a much stronger foundation. It's, as a parent, you know, the early ages seem easy in some ways. Young kids, you know, little kids, little problems, big kids, big problems. It's a, you know, it's not so easy being a parent of an older kid and teenagers, but they need you. Even if they don't interact every day with you, if you're there and they know you have that love and support, it's really helpful. And again, you can bond at any age. I there's never a better age. But the earlier, the better. That's why I start prenatally. That's why I like home visiting. I mean, that is why I encourage those things from a life course perspective.
And Haley, there was a question in the chat. Was that directed at anyone in particular? Where should we direct fathers looking for fatherhood, parenting groups, and resources?
I think it was more towards Children's Trust and or, you know, anybody who has resources in their area that they, you know, have as go-tos for our presenters.
So for some reason, I can't share with everyone, but Haley, I just sent you some links. I think you might be a co-host if you're willing to share those with folks. And we can send an email post-event too.
Thank you, Stacey. And George, did you have a question?
Yeah, I did. And it's funny, I've been on the board since January of 2015. And then you have conversations like this and think of things you never thought of before. And one of them is, I guess, directed. Maybe it's to Milt or to anybody with House of Corrections experience. Do we also research or study or track the impact to the children of the dads who've participated and graduated from the program? And just, is there like a, is there any data out there on like, because we did this, not only on the father, we know the results, we track the individual, but on the family as well. Is there any research out there on that?
Well, I'll speak there. The answer is yes. There's actually a lot, and it's just what you would expect. It's positive. There's a group of folks in California who have a curriculum. I'm blanking on its name. You can look up under Barry Brazelton's grouping. They're a big supporter of this particular fatherhood curriculum. I've forgotten what its name.
Supporting father involvement.
Supporting father involvement. Thank you. And they came from a research world initially, and they've been tracking the kids as well as the parents. So we're honoring fathers today, but it's actually, we did this for the kids. It's to prevent child abuse, among other topics. So there's a decrease in child abuse. For girls, they tend to be better in math. I mean, there's a whole series of things where fathers' presence and active engagement has really positive outcomes. And in programs like the ones we're working on now, it's not so easy to study, but it's really important. And I think the answer is yes. And I'd be happy to find resources if you want to locate some of those kinds of studies.
Thank you. I appreciate your insight. And I will make a note to myself. I'll track that down.
Okay.
And I think, so we're at time. I don't know, Chris, if you had any closing comments.
No, I do not. I just want to thank everyone for coming today. This is how we're able to serve more fathers and get more dads involved and have those positive impacts on children and families. So I just want to thank our sponsors and George, thank you.
So much. Yeah, no, we could clearly keep going on this conversation. It's a fascinating topic. It's important work. And I just am grateful to be a part of an organization that's leading not only in Massachusetts, but across the country. And, you know, also grateful to have the support of the host committee members that are here today. Again, thank our sponsors, thank the Children's Trust staff for leading in and putting together an event like this so we can continue to help raise awareness for the fatherhood programming. And really to advance the mission of the Children's Trust to prevent child abuse. So thank you all so much for making some time on your Friday morning. To anybody celebrating this weekend, happy Father's Day, and hope to see you all soon.
Thank you.
And thanks, everyone. Quickly before we leave, I see Margie Khan here. Hi, Margie. Thank you so much for the support of the initiative. George had mentioned your generous sponsorship earlier. We appreciate you.
You are welcome. And I just posted, in terms of research, fathers and kids, take a look at the work at Bank Street College.
Yep.
Excellent. Thank awesome. You.
Thank you again, everyone. Appreciate you all.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.